May I request Mu'mineen please to turn off your mobiles while you're inside the mosque. Ahsant. Please welcome Mu'allim Murza Bandali. Nari salawat bar Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أكرمه بالنبوة وجعله رحمة للعالمين وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. عباد الله اوصيكم واوصي نفسي بتقوى الله. All the servants of Allah, my brothers and sisters, first of all I inform myself, I advise myself, I exhort myself to observe the necessity of taqwa, and I would like to advise you as well. Amma ba'd. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I would like to talk today about the situation of our brothers, the Shia brothers in Indonesia. Last month, in the city of Bandung, Indonesia, an anti-Shia National Alliance gathering was organized in a mosque by some Muslim organizations. A number of them were from the Wahhabi Salafi background. Following months of violence targeted at the Shia community in Indonesia, Tarjono Abu Mu'az, well known as by the name of Abu Mu'az, he is the head of Indonesia Anti-Shia Alliance. He has struck fear into the hearts of our Shia brothers in the region. Mu'az's hatred for Shia Islam is so deep and so extreme that he has branded Shias, and I quote his own words, he has called us Shias as a virus that can destroy Islamic teachings, and he has also declared jihad against the Shias. May Allah save us. In a country of 250 million Muslims, the largest Muslim population in the world, Shias form only 1% of the population. A minimal minority, and still they are seen as a threat. This, you can see, has very little to do, something to do, but very little to do with the Shia theology itself. But it has very much to do with politics. In the last 10 days of April last year, the Anti-Shia Alliance mounted a vigorous campaign to discredit the general elections of members of parliament, which was taking place there. They were urging their supporters not to support the Democratic Liberal Party, where the governor of Jakarta, if he was appointed, would probably become the president of the country. And the reason for this propaganda against the Democratic Party was simply because it has nominated a top Shia personality in the West Java area as a candidate. The man's name is Dr. Jalaluddin Hikmat, who previously headed an organization, an umbrella organization of the Shia in Indonesia, a Shia organization. In that gathering of the anti-Shia alliance, a Salafi cleric, Maulana, just to create a climate of fear among the Indonesians, he urged them not to vote for the Democratic Party. Why? Because they said if their leader becomes the governor and the president, that he would nominate Dr. Hikmat as the head of the religious affairs. Just imagine, this was the propaganda. He said, as long as we, that is the Salafis, are not in power, we will never be able to purge the Shias. We need to strengthen our political base. This has been the pattern everywhere. As long as the Shias are docile, they are quiet, and do not raise any voice, and do not speak for their rights, they are good citizens. The trouble starts only if they speak out against denial of human rights, even if they happen to comprise the majority population in that country. Look at Lebanon. Before the time of Imam Musa Sadr in the 50s, the Shias were right at the bottom of the ladder. The moment they raised their voice about sharing the national resources, they became a problem. The trouble started when Imam Musa Sadr came in and brought about social political awakening among the Shias of Lebanon, and that is when the Shias woke up and started fighting for their rights. You see the same pattern in Bahrain, you see the same pattern in Iraq, in Saudi Arabia, and you also see the same pattern everywhere where a number of Middle Eastern countries, what they do, they use all their resources and wealth to destabilize those countries which are dominated by the Shias. What can we as Shias living far away do to help to come to the aid of our brothers everywhere and Indonesia especially? We can at least drop a letter, a polite letter to the Indonesian embassies, wherever they are, raising concern about the hatred being hyped up and the persecution of Shia minority in Indonesia, even though this has not been organized by the Indonesian government. I earnestly hope, that Shia leaders everywhere and the ulama will do something urgently to deal with this very dangerous trend before the situation gets out of hand. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower His blessings on the Shias of Amir al-Mu'mineen wherever they are and keep them under His protection. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala al-Nabi. Ya ayuhal ladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتاب الحكيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. First, a few words about this great month of Sha'ban before I come to the main khutbah today. The main subject. This holy month of Sha'ban carries great rewards, and they are reserved for those people who are fasting and paying charity, giving charity. Our holy prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam said, he said, shahrun sharifun wa huwa shahri. This is a sharif, it is a distinguished month, and it is my month. And then say, وَهُوَ شَهْرٌ يُزَادُ فِيهَا أَرْزَاقُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. It is the month in which the sustenance of believers is multiplied, is increased. وَالذَّنْبُ مَغْفُورٌ وَالْحَسَنَاتُ مَقْبُولَةٌ. And the sins are forgiven and the good deeds are accepted. It is highly recommended to do istighfar, which is one of the best zikr, and to recite salawat. In this month, Imam Ali alayhi salam and other imams used to recite a beautiful munajat called Munajat Sha'baniya. This was also one of the favorite munajat recited by Imam Khomeini rahmatullahi alayhi. Another famous supplication which we have just heard recited is Salawat Sha'baniya. Since it begins by repeatedly sending salawat to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his holy progeny, it is reported that Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam He used to recite this supplication every day in Sha'ban at the time of Zawal, at the time when the sun passes the meridian, and also on the night of the 15th of Sha'ban. This supplication is also known as Dua Shajarat Al-Nubuwa. That means the supplication of the tree of prophethood. Shajara is the tree. Since the supplication itself starts with these profound words. In today's khutbah, I would like to do a brief commentary of a very important surah. All the surahs are important, but this is a very important surah in that it is the essence of the Holy Quran. It is the summary of the entire Quran. This is Surah Al-Asr, Surah number 103. Wal-Asr. Inna al-insana lafi khusr. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. In this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes an oath of the time Asr to impress the point that man is in sheer loss, except those who have faith, who do good deeds, who exhort people to truth, and who exhort people and advise people to patience. Let us consider each of these qualities in order that we understand the meaning fully. Wal Asr. When Allah takes an oath, it is only because He wants to lay emphasis on something which is sacred, something which is powerful, something which is awe-inspiring. Allah is swearing by Asr, which is the continuity of time from the time of creation to the present time to the end of human life. The word Asr used in this surah also relates to the time in the past as well as the present. It is time absolute. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us human beings that we should reflect on the passage of time, how far time passes. That we should value time and regard it as a precious commodity and blessings given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That in the time that we have in this world, we should strive towards perfection. We should purify our soul and get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Man hardly takes it seriously that the time he has on this earth is short-lived and is ticking away very fast. We hardly notice this. Sadly, it becomes too late when man realizes with regrets at the end of his time upon his death that he has wasted his time and opportunities he had. Not only did he waste his time, but sometimes he even misused the time. Asr is also referring to the afternoon, the Asr prayers, which is the last prayer approaching the end of the day. If you think about it, that you'll come to realize that at the end of any day, when time has run out, we have already lost part of our capital. One day in our life. There cannot be a greater loss than the loss of this capital, time, which is man's most precious asset. This is the real wealth. Now, time is also a witness for those people and nations that were drunk with power, prestige, and abundant wealth. And they thought that they would last forever. You only need to look at history and you will find that generations after generations have come and gone, and they have gone without any trace. Where are those people and nations today who used to consider themselves to be very powerful and so rich? All that power and wealth has completely vanished. They've all ended up in the dust. The Holy Quran has repeatedly pointed out the fate of such people who have transgressed the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, in Surah Al-Ghafir, which is also called by another name, Surah Al-Mu'min, which is Surah number 40, verse number 21, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَوَلَمْ يَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَيَنْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الَّذِينَ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. Have they not traveled in the earth? Have they not seen the fate of those people before them? What was the end of these people before them? كانوا هم أشد منهم قوة وآثارا في الأرض. They were mightier than them in quwwah, in their power, and the traces that they left behind on this earth. فأخذهم الله بذنوبهم, and Allah struck them and seized them for their sins. وما كان لهم من الله من واق, and they had no one to defend them against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was the fate of the tyrants and the oppressors and those people who are mischief makers on this earth. The only real wealth which man possesses is the good deeds that he sends forth. عَمَلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ. Allah says in the Holy Quran in Surah An-Nahl, Surah number 16, verse number 96, مَا عِنْدَكُمْ يَنْفَدُ وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بَاقٍ. Whatever is with you will vanish, but whatever you send forth, whatever is with Allah, is what is going to endure, and that is what is going to remain. So spend your time wisely and usefully so that it serves you in the hereafter. The crux of this qasam which Allah has given in this surah is innal insana lafi khusr. Most certainly, no doubt, man is in a loss. The Quran has made this khusr a special term. Khasara, khasara. The opposite of this khusr is not gain. The opposite of this khusr is falah, is a true success. It refers to man's real failure and disappointment in this world and the hereafter. Insan here, innal insan, refers to all human beings, every single individual who lead a purposeless life with no ideals, no goals to go for in this life. The time wasters, people who waste their time, they cannot expect to accomplish anything in this world. Only the only ones who usefully use their time are the ones who are going to reap eternal fruits in this world and the hereafter. If life itself is taken as just a business bargain, where man lives only for himself and attends only to his own personal gains without sharing them, without spreading their bounties to others, then that is called a loss. What is a gain? A gain is when man contributes to humanity, when he renders service to mankind, and directing and encouraging others to truth and to justice and to patience. That is the real gain. There's a very interesting ayah in Surah Az-Zumar, Surah number 39, verse 15, which talks about who the real losers are. Because we human beings, the concept of loss differs with different human beings, the way we think what loss is. Let us see what Allah says. He says, فَعْبُدُوا مَا شِئْتُم مِّن دُونِ. You worship, you serve the way you want besides Allah. Then Allah says, let me inform you. Let me inform you what is the meaning of loss. And he says, قُلْ إِنَّ الْخَاسِرِينَ الَّذِينَ خَسِرُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَهْلِيهِمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. The truly the losers are those who lose themselves and their families on the يوم القيامة. أَلَا ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْخُسْرَانُ الْمُبِينُ. Now surely that is the clear loss. These are the people who are kept away from the mercy of Allah. They don't join their families on the يوم القيامة. You see, they not only lose their souls, but they lose their loved ones as well. You may gain the whole world, but if you lose your soul, and if you lose your loved ones, then you have lost everything. The only true gainers are who? إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. These are qualities which are obtained in those people who believe sincerely in Allah, His Messenger, and the Holy Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. You will find so many verses in the Holy Quran which talks about iman, about faith. I will not go into the details of this because of time constraint. After faith, the second quality which is required to save man from loss is what? وَتَوَاصَوْ بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْ بِالصَّبْرِ. After faith and عَمَلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ. However, according to the Quran, no act can be considered a good act unless it is accompanied first by iman. And unless it is performed in obedience and with the dictates of the Quran and the teachings of the Messenger Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. That is why in the Quran a call to perform good deeds is always preceded everywhere by faith. And in this surah Wal Asr also you'll see that it has been mentioned after faith. Amanu wa amilu salihati. The surah then mentions two qualities, as I just said, which a man must have in order to be saved. What is it? وَتَوَاسَوْ بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاسَوْ بِالصَّبْرِ. This implies in the first place, a believing and righteous people should not live an isolated, individualistic life, but they should create a believing and righteous society. Second, that every individual of a society must feel duty bound not to let that society become weak and corrupt. Thus, all members of the society are duty bound to counsel, to advise one another to truth and steadfastness. In Ahsan al Hadith, wa ablagh al mawa'idhati kitabullah, a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim, wal 'asr, innal insana lafi khusr. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوب وهو الغفور الرحيم. سبحان من سبقت رحمته غضبه وبسط اليدين بالرحمة. سبحان من لم يكلف نفسا إلا دون وسعها وعفى عن السيئات ولم يجاز بها. سبحان من لا يزداد على معاصي العباد إلا كرما وجودا وعلى كثرة الذنوب إلا عفوا وصفحا. نشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العطوف على العباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه. ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه. وحبيبه سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين بعثه رحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعم ومعدن الرحمة. اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله. وعلى إمام المسلمين وقائد الغر المحجلين أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وآله. وعلى سيدتي نساء العالمين وبضعة خاتم النبيين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها. وعلى الحسن المجتبى. والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء. وعلي بن الحسين. ومحمد بن علي. وجعفر بن محمد. وموسى بن جعفر. وعلي بن موسى. ومحمد بن علي. وعلي بن محمد. والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على مولانا صاحب الزمان محيا ثار البدع والطغيان، هادم أبنية الشرك والنفاق، حاصل فرع البغي والشقاق، صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آبائه الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام. اللهم عجل فرجه وسهل مخرجه، واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه، واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه، وتفضل على أمرائنا المؤمنين بمزيد التوفيقات وازدياد الإقبال وعلو الدرجات. اللهم افعل بنا ما أنت أهله، ولا تفعل بنا ما نحن أهله، بجاه محمد وآله المعصومين صلوات الله عليهم أجمعين. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يتذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن علي ولي الله، أشهد أن عليا حجة الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، حي على الفلاح، حي على خير العمل، حي على خير العمل. قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله. إني وجهت وجهي للذي فطر السماوات والأرض.